we can see again the orbital mechanics in effect as these stars begin to dance around a binary black hole system. Nope. That got noped. This one's getting noped. Left and right. Now what are these remnants here? Thank you. interesting, some black holes, what we know about them, some of the categories of black holes. Let's see, let's put one, Sagittarius. Jesus, it's 4 million suns. Sagittarius A is the black hole at the center of our Milky Way. So let's just go ahead and put one right here. We'll start off. Objects with extreme density. We're going to go ahead and put our sun, which is a yellow main sequence star. That the sun is still. Sorry, Oh, there. It's like the sun is still maintaining some of its integrity. Sorry, maybe I should have picked a dimmer star. I'm not trying to give you guys any. Shocks. Albert Einstein first predicted black holes in 1916 with his general theory of relativity. The term black hole was actually coined much later in 1967 by the American astronomer John Wheeler, and the first one was discovered not long after in 1971. Sagittarius A star is absolutely moving with respect to the coordinates of this game. Oops, I didn't mean to do that. I guess once I click the left mouse button, see the tidal forces, but take particularly on these guys, but even these ones, as the gravitational pull is so extreme that even from one side of this star to the next, there's a differential. More gravitational acceleration on this side, the inside of the star, than there is on the outside of the same star. So that the velocity, the force felt, is actually different depending on which side, the near or the far side of the star you're on. Let's try to give a more three-dimensional view. So this is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 stars. There are 21 times the mass of our sun, our star, being herded gravitationally by the black hole at the center of our Milky Way galaxy. When Einstein developed relativity theory, it took him about 10 years to work out the math using a daunting form of mathematics called tensor calculus. He was only able to approximate the solutions to his own equations, and the math still perplexes even the best scientific brains. However, the challenge did nothing to deter one of Einstein's contemporary astronomers, a theoretical physicist named Carl Schwarzschild. Schwarzschild, a very very consonant-rich last name, was a practical individual by nature. He pioneered new methods for studying spectra, for example. Excelled in his abilities to deal with the theoretical concepts, and when Einstein's articles on general relativity were published in 1915, Schwarzschild was one of the first to recognize, well, let's put Betelgeuse here, to recognize their importance. Oh my god, Betelgeuse is huge. This is like just a massive star. I just put right in the path of the black hole, the equivalent to 4.3 million times the size of our star. You can only imagine what happens here. Sagittarius right here. Oh, this is gonna get interesting here. You can see it right off there in the distance. The gravitational equations, the dynamics between these forces here are going to get very interesting. But what's even more interesting is that these are mere simulations, vast oversimplifications of phenomena that we have actually observed, not necessarily with visible light. Although I believe we've done it with that too, but oh, look at that, the star is getting ripped apart by both black holes. It's getting much closer too.
Physical calculations.
published his work titled On the Field of Gravity of a Point of Mass in the Theory of Einstein, which became one of the pillars. Look at that. I love watching it get bent. That's such a brilliant simulation. Look at that, one star becomes two. It became one of the pillars of relativistic studies. And in it, Schwarzschild presented the solutions to Einstein's unfinished equations. Support for a then seemingly implausible situation about the effects of severely compressed matter on gravity and energy. So when Einstein wrote his general theory of relativity, he found a way, a new way, in fact, to describe gravity. It was not a force, as Sir Isaac Newton had proposed, but a consequence of a distortion in space and time, conceived together in his theory as space-time. According to Einstein, matter and energy exist on a background of space and time. There are three spatial dimensions, as we can see, and one time dimension, as we could see if we were to pause everything and continue. I really love this kaleidoscopic effect of these clouds. Damn, this is so beautiful. Let's get a little more of that lensing. You guys are enjoying this too. By the way, I wanted to dedicate this episode to a big supporter of the channel, Hard Yakka, Steve. Yeah, because I have two Steves that are being really generous, and you guys are showing a lot of support. I wanted to differentiate you two using your username. But Yakka, you know who you are, and you and Scrappy both have been a big support, big encouragement, big motivation, and just, it's been really nice. It's really pleasant to hear that you're enjoying this. Oh, look what just popped back into frame here. So, I wanted to, you requested another universe sandbox episode, and I hope I'm able to do your request some justice by adding a little extra dimension and try to learn a little something about what it is we can play around in, play around with in the sandbox, so to speak. Regardless, this was a blast, and I just really appreciate that you enjoy my content, and especially one of these types of episodes, which probably only second to the philosophy are my favorite to make. So this was my pleasure, and I really hope you and Scrappy happy. Enjoy it. So, what did Einstein do with his concept of a fluid continuum of space and time, three dimensions of space, one of time? As opposed to Newton's conception of a force, of mass and acceleration multiplying to give a force and interacting with other objects with mass. Einstein perceived the interaction of objects in space with one another as a, that's it, another black hole, no, that's it, some more stars. Let's go with a nice dim one. Is there a really red one? I don't see a really, really red one. But Einstein perceived it as objects distort the fabric of space-time based on their mass. More massive objects, of course, have a greater effect. Let's go with this one. Immediately gets warmed. That's the brightest one there is. Barnard star. That's a red main sequence dwarf star. Thank you. space-time deformation. It's due to the speed at which they're traveling. So, perhaps that's why this star is failing to get absorbed by this black hole, Sag-A, which is over 4.3 million times the mass of our star. So matter tells space-time how to curve, and space-time tells matter how to move. So Schwarzschild realized the escape velocity from the surface of an object depends on both its mass and its radius. But if nature can make the radius of a given mass small enough, such as our black hole here, then the escape velocity, the velocity at which a particle needs to be moving to effectively escape the gravitational pull, these massive objects. I keep forgetting I'm launching these. Let's go binary. Escape velocity is a very crucial concept in all of astrophysics, rocket science, cosmology. But if we have a black hole which is essentially the inside a supernova the whole time, which is essentially a the most an extreme of the most mass that can fit in the smallest area, then the escape velocity will increase until it reaches the speed of light, which is the universe's ultimate static constant speed, velocity, time at which the fastest particle that we know of can travel between two points, which is 300,000 kilometers per second. Now at that point, neither the matter nor the radiation can escape from the object's surface. Additionally, atomic and subatomic forces become incapable of holding the object up against its own weight. Therefore, the object collapses into an infinitesimal point. The original object disappears from view, and only its gravity remains to mark its presence. As a result, it creates a bottomless pit in the fabric of space-time. Now refer to an object with zero volume, but all of its mass, as a singularity. We have two of them over here. Schwarzschild also explained that a singularity was surrounded by a spherical gravitational boundary that forever trapped anything that ventured within, and this boundary was called the famous event horizon. I should say the now famous, as he's the one who coined the term. Okay. Presented a formula that enabled the size of an event horizon to be calculated, and this is known as the Schwarzschild radius, as it marks the edge of the bottomless pit in space-time. You venture beyond this, you'll never return. What the heck? 2001 Space Odyssey. Pretty sure that's what just happened. Positively constructive criticism. Give me feedback. Let me know what you liked, what you didn't. If you're still up watching this, then I couldn't have been that good at giving you ASMR, but perhaps I just relaxed you for a nice afternoon snooze, which would be equally pleasant to have done. So if you enjoy this, then give it a like. Hit that dislike if you didn't, guys. Smash that dislike. Unsubscribe. Tell me why I suck. But if that's not the case, ways then interact and come visit me on my IG and my Twitter and let me know what you guys think of the channel. And throw out some suggestions. I love listening to it. I have a backlog of quite a few ones I already have to I have planned that I intend to do soon, but your suggestions always help me, like I say, always steer my channel in the right direction, and your kind words are always welcome. I enjoy and look forward to interacting with all you guys, and I'll see you on the next video. I hope you guys sleep very well tonight. And before I let you go, I just want to give a personal thank you to Steve and Tim. You guys are awesome. I really appreciate you. You're just really encouraging. And it means a lot. Motivate me to keep going, and yeah, I just want to give you a really warm thank you, because that was so kind of you guys to support the channel the way you did. And of course, Argyaka, you and Old Scrap, you guys are always a pleasure to chat with. I look forward to hearing what you think about this episode. And Jody, I want to thank you too. I was so happy to hear from you the other day. And you supported the channel, and you suggested for me to tap back into the comic books, which I'm really glad you did, because I actually just found a whole slew of old comic books. I guess that sounds like a lot more than it is. It's really only about 20, maybe less. But, so yeah, you absolutely have that one coming right around the corner. And as for everybody else, Sandy, Potato Launch, Donna, you're awesome. I always look forward to your comments. Antoine, Sean, Andy, Josh, Alexander, thank you guys so much. Your support means everything to me right now, because, well, this channel's kind of on limbo right now. It's potentially going on a hiatus. I have a job shift coming up, and I don't know if I'm going to have the time to keep creating videos. So, yeah, your support just really means a lot to me, and I just didn't want it to go unnoticed and unthanked and unappreciated. So, what you've given already is more than enough, and each and every one of you, just, it means so much that you guys would throw anything towards the channel, so it's just a pleasure. It makes me happy. So I wish you guys a fond farewell, a sweet good night, and a solid sleep. Hope you wake up refreshed, feeling good and limber, ready to tackle the day. Until next episode. Sleep well. And do your best.